Hey everyone, welcome to the Accidental Wrestling Fan. In the studio is Lino, John, and myself, Damon. Kaz is out today. Kaz is on assignment. He's got some business to take care of outside of the podcast, so we'll probably be hanging out with Kaz next week.
Did you guys see those posts on the WWE Instagram today of the superstars in New York City?
No.
Like in full character. It was one of the wildest things I've ever seen, because at first I thought it was like Kalisto, Jinder Mahal, Matt Hardy, and they're in full gimmick. Yeah. And I thought they were just photoshopped into these stock photos of downtown Manhattan.
Kind of how they've done stuff in the past.
Yeah. And then I went on their Instagram story and like, no, they're actually just hanging out. Huh? Yeah, it's pretty crazy. Oh, you guys got to check it out later. But that just like, I just pictured Kaz like doing that kind of stuff, but for Pod Bros, like
that's exactly we didn't want to spill it. There goes the secret.
Kayfabe.
Yeah,
he's wearing our new WCW inspired "We're the Big Bros" play.
That's
shirt
right. Yeah,
on our T Public page. Thank you, Mr. Jeff of the PH. We appreciate all the effort in designing our shirts. Go to tee.pub/lic/PodBros, PODBROS, and you can get all of our designs on there, stickers, pillows. So if you want to, sleep with Toph, you can go there and do that.
Oh, man, who doesn't want all sleep with Toph, right?
Yeah, let us pin you for the three count.
Are we Toph clean right now?
No.
Okay. Do you think anyone's ever gotten laid because of Toph? Like maybe they got the one of those pillowcases and like, chick walked in.
I'm looking at someone right now that I know that got laid because it's off. So
what? Good thing our listeners don't know who you're looking at. Yikes.
Yikes. All right. Other housekeeping. You can also give us money via Patreon. And we have a new feature. Well, Patreon is a new feature where you can just give us the money straight up. You can just give it to us right away so you don't have to worry about it coming out of your account later down the line, or if you got the cash on hand and just want to give it to us at that moment, feel free to do so. I or John will have to set that up on the page.
Yeah. I'll
it's one of those things like, oh, we should do that. Then you forget about it.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
6 months later, you're like, oh, shit, we should probably do that.
Yeah.
So patreon.com/podbros. And make sure you get in on that Toph tier because you get to come on the show or via sending your list to us, coming to the studio if you're local, calling us, whatever it is, and you get to tell us your five favorite matches.
Mm-hmm.
Five favorite matches. And actually, you know, we'll make it topical. If you give us some money on Patreon, we'll let you tell us your favorite SummerSlam matches. But I mean, you've got a week to do that, so get on it.
Hurry up.
Time flies.
That's right. And if you wanted to buy, say, old school SummerSlam 88 Feel the Heat shirt on Amazon, you can go to podbros.com, scroll to the bottom of our homepage, and click the Amazon banner. It doesn't cost you anything extra, but it helps us out.
That's right.
There it is.
That was good. Thank you.
Joe Rogan, eat your heart out.
That's right, man.
All right. So today, what do we got? Well, unfortunately, if you're a fan of the Second City Saints, they have completely imploded. I was singing a little song, a little ditty on the way to the studio, and it goes a little something like this. me. Look in my eyes. What do you see? My best friend's fucking Sue and me. Colt Cabana is suing CM Punk.
Yeah, man.
And this is from, oh, man. I've got the entire story in front of me, but there's no
Chicago
source for it.
Chicago Tribune?
Chicago Tribune.
I don't think it was the Tribune. Maybe it was
the Sun-Times.
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 Yeah.
There we go. Yep. I would have failed in college for that. Let's see. Colt Cabana is suing CM Punk for breach of contract and fraud following the recent defamation lawsuit win over WWE's Dr. Chris Amon. Did we ever figure out how to say that? A man?
Chris Amon? That's a good question.
Yeah, I know how to spell it, but I don't know how to say it. Sorry, doctor.
We should get him on the podcast. He's probably a big fan of wrestling podcasts.
The lawsuit claims, quote, Brooks acted with fraud and malice and oppression towards Colton, which is Colt Cabana's real last name, with the deliberate intention of causing Colton harm. Colton is reported with legal fees up to $513,736, which Punk said were, quote, 100% covered in a text message, but things between the good friends have seemingly turned sour when Brooks allegedly said, "You are on your own." Colt looking to receive $200,000 in general damages plus $1 million in punitive and exemplary damages. It's worth noting that while both started the lawsuit with the same legal team at some stage during the proceedings, this changed and Colt hired his own attorney, or Cabana. So yeah, that is that's wild, man. These guys have known each other for 20 years, and
yep,
they. Man, it's kind of wild.
Yeah, they had the complaint right here, too, and I'm just taking a look at it and basically saying, bringing up the whole podcast again, how...
In the actual complaint, Cabana definitely takes a big, a dig at him, a very serious dig about Punk basically becoming an asshole.
Yeah, this is interesting.
I can't believe... So Punk asked Cabana to pay half of the legal fees, which comes out to $256,868, saying you are on your own. Imagine just trying to say that sentence seriously to one of your friends, I needed to pay $250,000. Damon, I couldn't even imagine being oh, yeah, we just went through all this. You need to pay $256,000. You're on your own here, bud.
I don't even understand where he's going to get that money from to pay that.
I mean, yeah, Colt Cabana's not a UFC fighter like CM. Well, neither might be CM Punk, but...
oh, my gosh.
Yeah, you're using that term really loosely.
Okay, Section 18 of the complaint. However, in late April of 2016, and despite Brooks's representation and agreement to make sure that Colton would be 100% covered with respect to the claims in the Amon lawsuit... Brooks suddenly demanded that Colton pay one or more of the Loeb firm's statements for legal services in the Amon lawsuit, emailing to Colton as follows. To this date, I have spent $513,736 on this Amon lawsuit. My outstanding current bill is at least $300,000. Half of all this is yours. Divide that big amount that I just mentioned by two, and that is what you owe me and what I expect you to pay me. Starting now, I will no longer be paying your bills. You are on your own. Whatever my bill is currently will be cut in half, and half will be yours. If you choose to make this all ugly, that's fine too. I hope you won't, but I gave up on you doing what is right a long time ago. Whoo, Punk throwing shade, man. Wow.
Man, it's funny, he says that, but then, Punk... bitching and complaining on that podcast is the whole reason why they're even in that situation in the first place.
Right.
And Cabana was his friend and wanted to give him an avenue to vent about his, all of the shit that happened with him leaving WWE.
Colt was just giving him a platform. Cabana wouldn't even have been qualified enough to speak poorly about this doctor anyway.
Yeah,
this is all Punk.
And then he doesn't speak badly about the doctor.
Right.
At least according to the suit. And I know that they asked him to take the lawsuit down, and Cabana didn't, or the lawsuit, I'm sorry, the podcast. If he had taken the podcast down, he would have been able to avoid a lawsuit. But, it's one of those things. He felt like he wasn't doing anything wrong. He was just letting someone vent their frustration and say how they were feeling or their side of the story. As far as Punk goes, and I'm starting to kind of get to the point where, I feel sick of fucking talking about this guy.
Mm-hmm.
He hates... it's very obvious that he hates wrestling. And, you hear stories from different wrestlers like Hornswoggle, where he kind of just cuts people out of his life. They're still attached to wrestling. And the thing with Corey Graves, I don't give... I don't really want to give a fuck about this guy anymore. Especially watching someone treat one of your friends like this, like a guy that... you went through the fucking trenches with trying to make your name through wrestling, a guy that's been with you through thick and thin, and an insane lawsuit when both you guys are getting sued by your former employer. To see him kind of turn his back on a friend like that is real disheartening.
Yeah, especially after, like you said, he could have just taken the podcast down, but no, he
had his friend's back.
Exactly, you
know? Yeah. Yeah, man. What and, you thought was your friend.
Yeah, and now you got to assume because he told you, I got you, you're good. And then he's like, oh, no, like, no, you actually owe me money for this. It'd be like I saw someone online say, oh, I'll ask my friend if he wants to go out for a nice steak dinner. And then when the bill comes, like, oh, by the way, you owe me $45 for the steak dinner.
I've had those friends. You're just like, you want to go out to dinner? They invite you out. And you're thinking, oh, man, this is so nice. And they're like, yeah, that bill is going to be $45 for you. Like, what?
Separate checks.
Oh, yeah, we're separate.
Yeah.
That'd be like if you're going on a date with someone, they offered to pay, and then at the end of the date when dinner's over, like, yeah, well, we're actually separate.
What the fuck? Oh, man, the fact that he's alleging fraud too is kind of crazy.
Kind of oh my god,
Punk is alleging fraud.
No.
Oh, I was going to say, okay.
So, Colton is informed and believes, and based thereon alleges that Brooks correctly believed that absent his representation and agreement that Colton would be 100% covered, in quotes, in connection with the demands made upon Colton and the something Colton that got cut off, Colton would have complied with each of said demands.
So, what this is, this whole thing, and what a lot of these other issues within this whole case and saga, get everything in writing, even if they are your friend. Like, hey, I'm going to need you to write that down.
Well, there is one. So Punk's lawyer, there's one piece here that really made me go, oh, okay. Brenner, who I guess was Punk's lawyer, emailed Cabana saying, ... despite your unwillingness to contribute to your legal fees, I am still prepared to represent you. And Phil is prepared to have me represent you and cover your legal fees going forward. As long as there is no conflict between you and Phil that prevents me from fairly and ethically representing you. At this time, I don't believe that any such conflict exists. Ooh, man. Okay, so, like, I could see having to pay the fees beforehand, but from that moment on up...
From the date of that email.
Yeah.
That definitely sounds like that your Phil legal said, fees are covered.
Your attorney said Phil agreed to this, and it's going, oh, okay. So I could see having to pay, you know, CM Punk having to pay his fees on that date going forward. I don't see him having to pay the back fees, though.
I also have had the realization that I need to start just charging for services, whatever the fuck a lawyer charges, because Jesus Christ.
I was just going to say, they didn't lose this lawsuit against the doctor, but look at all this money they have to pay just in legal fees.
That's usually why in these cases, and I think I said it before to you guys, a lot of people just go to, they settle.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because even the legal fees get so out of hand. So it's like, so you ridiculous. Both go through this. And the losing party has to pay out money. They got to pay out money. Then they still got to pay their lawyers on top of that.
A lot of it falls into a period called discovery, which basically, like, both sides have to give up evidence and stuff of what they have. You can't hold anything. You can't hold this, like, smoking gun or a trump card of like, a piece of evidence. It has to be all brought forward. So that takes a lot of time and money right there.
Yep.
And that's where a big chunk of your bill comes from. Not to mention you're paying for your lawyer's expenses, you know, if it has to, you know, meals, travel, sometimes it depends. So expert testimony, experts, witnesses.
Damn, this legal firm spent a lot of time at Giordano's then.
Yeah, dude.
Portillo's.
Give the beef dip.
I think my new life goal is to never be sued for anything. Never, like, even be attempted to be sued.
I'm very happy that a lawsuit that I was, a defendant, and it was settled.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very happy I didn't have to go to court. And they settled, seriously, like, the Friday we were supposed to go to court on Monday.
That's usually how it happens. I
already taken time off work and everything, like, to prepare to have to go to court.
Jeez.
And I was like, I don't even know what I'm supposed to say. I don't even know what I'm supposed to do because of, you know, at the time I was only like 25 or 6. I'm like, I don't even know how the fuck a lawsuit works. I don't know what I'm supposed to do or say. I just got to sit up here and people are going to ask me a bunch of fucking questions.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, I already went through all this in the discovery period. I had to do my deposition. Thank you.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is fucking terrible. I was so stressed out horrible dreams.
Yeah, man, it is.
Then that was just for an accident. These guys, like, they're getting sued for half a fucking $1 million. Yeah. That's right. So much money. Even still, you know, Punk wants him to pay, what, $250,000?
Yeah, mm-hmm.
That's a lot of fucking
that's
money.
That's a lot. That's not a lot of money to Punk. That's a lot of money to Colt Cabana, though.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I mean, Colt's made a good living for himself, but that's nowhere near what WWE money can give you. That's just, you know, that's a lot of money. I feel this. Normally, I would say this is going to settle, but I even think I said with the Mon lawsuit that's going to settle before, you know, but Punk's, he's bullheaded, man. So I wouldn't be surprised if this goes to court.
I mean, he's the same guy that disowned his own brother for something.
Yeah, dude, yeah.
So he is very much the kind of person that doesn't forgive or forget.
Yeah, man. Yeah, very much so. Very much so. He's.
Could you guys imagine if this was all a work? And then we're going to get Colt Cabana versus CM Punk at All In.
I was saying, the way this is going, if this gets any messier, we might see Punk's third MMA fight.
Yeah, yeah, man. Yeah, seriously.
You know, people are joking and saying, like, well, it looks like Punk to pay for all the legal fees for this, too. Mm-hmm. Looks like he's going to have to come back to wrestling.
Yeah,
that's going to be everyone's first thought. It's like...
Right, that's the problem. It's Flair, right? Mm-hmm. It's Flair, basically, in a weird way, but... Punk is so, from what you read, is so stingy with his money. I seriously don't think that this is anything to him. Who was it? I think Ariel Helwani or someone else was in that car. This just came up. Like, all of a sudden, Punk was like, oh, yeah, hey, meet up with me. And it's three guys. I can't remember who it is. Punk pulls up in an old beat-up car. And he's like, oh, Ariel, just ride in the trunk, man. There's enough room. Just hop in the trunk. And then when we get to the place, you get out. And Ariel's like, no, I'm going to squeeze into the back seat with everyone else, you know. He's like, I don't care. And everyone's just kind of blown away. They're like, Punk, you have all this money and you pull up in like this 1980s boat. It was absolutely hilarious. But I'm just like, that sounds like him. That's not the first story that I've heard that he's pretty stingy with his money.
And he had the balls to ask Ariel Helwani to hop in the trunk.
Yeah, go in the trunk.
Ariel Helwani is like 6'2".
That's the thing. I was like, that dude, it just blew my mind. I thought I would love to be there at that moment. I probably would have started just laughing.
Yeah, it's just mind-blowing that this is what this has come to.
Yeah, you know, man.
Between...
Yeah. I don't know. You know, I personally can't say that I know the guy. I've never met him.
No.
There's never, but every time I see CM Punk, I always just feel like I would hate to be his friend because I'd be stressed all the time because of the saying the wrong word to him. He's just kind of has that personality to me. Like, I'd just be like, hey, what's up? And he'd be like, what do you mean by that? And I'd be like, all right, dude, I'm done.
Yeah. He also seems like the kind of guy I can see why other people don't like him and want to punch him in the face, because he'd have you swearing up and down on all the shoot interviews that he did back in the day. He's the fucking toughest guy in pro wrestling.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Telling the story how he like stomped the guy in the hand and kicked him in the face, and it's like, well, that was a lie.
Right.
Maybe you're the fucking toughest dude in fucking the West Loop in Chicago, you goofball. But it's kind of been exposed, Phil. You're not as tough as you think you are.
Don't call him Phil in public.
What's he going to do, throw shitty punches at me? Oh, no.
Yeah, we already had this discussion, who could beat him in stand-up.
I think that's right.
I think we all agreed we could take Punk out in stand-up for sure.
Yeah, I mean, man. I think if me and Punk were in the octagon for, like, you know, 5 minutes, I think he would beat me within that 5 minutes. But I'm saying, like, if we're just talking, like, one punch, he punches me once, I punch him once, I think I can knock him out. I think I got a chance to knock him out.
Almost like those slap battles.
It's yeah,
like,
exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so, man.
Yeah. Is this like a fucking duel?
Yeah,
like,
pretty much.
Draw.
Yeah. Man. All right, who goes first? Rock, paper, scissors. Okay.
But enough about about Phil.
Not trying to shit on him or anything, but it just... This doesn't surprise me, though.
It's hard to say nice things about the guy at this point.
Yeah, I think he could cut a great promo. I'll say that. That's one nice thing about him.
There you go.
Yeah.
Bring it
back. It's not all negative.
Okay. Yeah. He's great at wrestling and doing promos. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But as a person, he seems like the kind of person you wouldn't want to be around.
Yeah, man.
I mean, and, you know, other wrestlers. Like, I think we said that about Daniel Bryan. I'm like, I don't think I could be around Daniel Bryan longer than, like, 5 minutes.
Yeah, I couldn't either. I'd just be like, oh, this guy. especially when I saw him no-sell the Pocky One Chip Challenge, which you can watch on our YouTube page of Jeff and myself doing it.
Shout-outs to Phone Apple.
Yeah.
We have the remnants of the Pocky Challenge here in the studio,
right.
Too.
Yeah, yeah. Daniel Bryan no-selling that one chip challenge. I was like, fuck you, man. Jesus. I'm like, this guy.
Daniel Bryan wasn't too happy when you asked him to if you could choke him out with your tie, remember?
Yeah, he said no one would believe that, and yeah. I'm like, yeah, they would. I'm bigger than
you.
Yeah,
dude, yeah.
He was just like, no.
I'm like, okay, Daniel. Like, geez, like, it's a fucking picture. Can you just take the picture or not? Jesus Christ.
Right.
I'd be like, first, you don't know me. Second, I definitely have a height and reach advantage on you, so there's that.
Fuck it. I just asked for a picture because everyone else was like, can you choke me with the tie? And he's like, oh, yeah, sure. Yeah. I'm like, hey, can I get a picture of me choking you? And then he no-sold it in the picture.
Yeah, I know. I was going to say that, too.
He just, made this, frowning face, come on, Daniel. Yep. Like, I'm a fucking fan of yours. Help a brother out here, man.
Yeah, man.
I still have that tie somewhere in my house because it's the same tie color that he would, it's the same, color pattern as his old maroon gear
in
the day.
Yep. Yeah.
And somewhere upstairs in my house, it says, Brian Danielson.
Oh, he signed it?
Yeah, on the inside of the tie. Shit.
Do you wear that, to events?
The tie is, comically long. It goes down, my fucking shins.
I was going to say, should we add it to the wall of the Pabro studio?
It would be
if
awesome if you would have worn it.
I'll bring it in.
That would have been hilarious, if you would have worn it to a wedding or something like that. Your Brian Danielson tie.
Yeah, I'll wear it for my job interview tomorrow.
There you go.
Yeah. Oh, they're like, why are you wearing a blue shirt and this comically oversized maroon tie?
Oh.
It's good luck.
Yeah. Are you okay? Are you at the right interview? I'm at the right place. Thank you.
Things look dragging around behind me like a fucking scarf.
Yeah, blowing in the wind. It gets caught in the door.
Whoa, what's that noise?
Remnants of Pod Bros After Dark, which you can get on patreon.com/podbros.
Exactly. Have we done a Pod Bros After Dark recently?
No, not recently. Mm-hmm. I did one with Jeff, actually.
I'll have to check that out.
Sneak preview. This is what you're missing. Tyrannosaurus Rex genitalia.
Wow. So. From Southland?
Yes.
Yes. Let's go.
Yep.
Speaking of genitalia, someone suffered an injury to a region near his genitalia, and that's poor Aleister Black.
Oh.
Yeah, suffered a torn groin.
I know.
Ouch.
That hurts, man. Oh, I had a pulled one. I can't imagine a torn one.
I had a strained groin because my wrestling coach in middle school did a move called a split crotch, or a guillotine if you were a more advanced wrestler.
Yeah, I was gonna
say. He did the version when he's got the referee's position and he hooks his, he laces his leg in, he rolls over the top of you Oklahoma roll.
Yep.
And he completely fucked me up.
Oh, motherfucker.
Thanks, coach. So... Aleister Black injured himself in a match. He got crotched in the top rope, and that's how it happened. I can't believe that hasn't happened more. Imagine what that feels like to have a torn groin, and it's kind of mind-blowing. Not necessarily mind-blowing, but I'm kind of shocked that more wrestlers don't get hurt doing that spot where they get crotched on the top rope.
Because
the ropes, you can attest to this, John, you can attest to it. Mm-hmm. Those ropes aren't, soft.
No,
they're
not at all.
They hurt.
Right.
And... to do that where you fall on the top rope like that, you have to catch yourself with your hands, but if you don't catch yourself with your hands right, you fall in a weird way, you can really, really mess yourself up.
Mm-hmm. So that is kind of surprising if it doesn't happen more often, yeah.
I thought for sure it happened to John Morrison, about 10 years ago, one of the Money in the Bank matches, because he fell up high from one of the ladders and he tried to catch himself, but he completely missed his hand placement.
God.
He was just straight groin first, and then he was on the ground he tore his groin. He had to.
Oh, man.
But he ended up being fine.
Mm.
But
Dave Meltzer's saying that it's more serious than a groin tear, but doesn't
specify what
it doesn't really give much more than that.
So they probably a torn groin, probably something to do maybe a hip flexor,
something like
hip adductor. There's so many different muscles and things that you can tear in that area, so it sucks. It sucks to have any sort of injury at all, especially in an area like that.
Very sensitive area.
Yeah, and basically all of his, oh, not just all of his offense, but a lot of his offense is like kicking and kneeing. Yeah. So, you know, it could be maybe wear and tear from that kind of exacerbated by falling onto the top rope like that. Who knows?
Do you even know, like, is there surgery that can repair this?
He's supposed to have a surgery because they thought it was just a flat-out torn groin, and they said that he could have the surgery and be good to go in a couple weeks. But then,
I'm afraid to even look at that surgery.
Yeah, I don't want to look at that. But then, of course, when Meltzer came out and said that the injury was more serious, and he, even if he had the initial injury and initial surgery, he'd still be out of takeover no matter what.
Yeah. One website just reported 2 minutes ago that he had the surgery, that he already underwent the surgery.
Oh, wow.
Did they say, was it just for a torn groin or anything else?
No, it's the same website that noted that Meltzer said that it was more serious than a groin tear, but that was all they said. Nothing more than that.
Well, so, they ended up writing him out on NXT. The video, which is a hilarious video, by the way. I don't know if you guys have seen it, but there's two or three different videos, I should say. The initial video is William Regal talking to one of the, you know, NXT interviewers backstage, and then someone runs in and says something to him. Then he runs out the back door. Johnny Gargano walks past him, and then he's walking down. The camera's following him. Undisputed Era is in the convertible, and they're listening to their own theme song, which is hilarious, by the way.
Nice.
And then Adam goes, "Kyle, go, go, go." So they're like trying to plant all these seeds, like of a whodunit kind of thing. And if you notice different camera angles, you always see this person with a yellow hoodie on and red tights walking away from the camera with everyone else, but everyone else is kind of congregating. Mm-hmm. They're all walking towards the they're all walking
Hogan's the unknown assailant.
Oh, let me tell you something, brother. I'm not going to this Dutch son of a bitch run my territory.
There's only one big boot here, brother. That comes from me.
This makes sense, though, because Hogan wants to manage Velveteen Dream. So we're going to get a Velveteen Dream with Hulk Hogan, Aleister Black feud when he comes back.
There's another angle where, you know, you see like Shayna Baszler walking, and then there's a couple other tag teams hanging out. They show like the heavy machine going over. Heavy machine is looking over, and Otis Dozovic goes, Hey Allie, you okay, man? He keeps calling him Allie over and over again. And then they did another shot where they go, hey, did you guys see anything? And Cassius Ohno, Kairi Sane, Candice LeRae, they're all like, no, we haven't seen anything. Ricochet is all concussed from getting beat up by the Undisputed Era. So he's like, I have no clue what's happening. But Ciampa walks by. He's like staring at his belt. He went on Twitter and said that he was the one that did that. And then Gargano was walking away from the scene, so they seem to be the two culprits. But again, everything seems to be kind of pointing back to the figure in the yellow. There's some speculation online that both Gargano and Ciampa agreed to take out Black so they could have each other to themselves at Brooklyn next week. But Lars Sullivan hasn't been seen on TV. Because he has a kayfabe broken jaw from Black Mass. So that would make sense if Lars came back and attacked him, took him out. And then they kind of reveal that that's the dude that wanted his revenge for his broken jaw. That makes the most sense. So it was announced that Gargano and Ciampa 3 at TakeOver Brooklyn 4 would be a last man standing match, at least according to Ciampa's Twitter. I am very excited for that match. I know a lot of people wanted to see the first Hell in a Cell at a NXT event. Of course, you can easily circumvent that by just having both guys be down for the count of 10. Then they can do the Hell in a Cell where there must be a winner. So obviously Aleister Black won't be around to do that triple threat match. And it's not like he's going to get the belt anyway. This seemed like a way they could get the belt off of him and probably call him up. Word, but Shoei goes on, I don't know. But yeah, so exciting stuff going on in NXT.
Anyone in this room going to NXT Detroit?
I will be at Travis's wedding.
Oh, nice.
Nice.
I don't plan on it, but I'm a never say never kind of a guy.
Yeah, me too.
So right? This is what, October?
No, it's September 8th.
Okay, September 8th.
Yeah, 8th or 9th?
Might be in Chicago. I don't know.
All for other stuff.
Yeah, work related. I was going to try to plan it when it would be at the same time as All In, so that I could just be like, all right, well, I'm just going to head on down to the city and see if I can scalp a ticket here.
Oh, nice.
Get in.
While we're on the topic of All In, it was revealed that they'd have some distribution / television / pay-per-view. It's kind of complicated, but not really.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Somehow it's a part of the Honor Club package for Ring of Honor, but you can also watch the first hour, the pre-show, if you will, Zero Hour, I think that's what they're calling it.
Yep.
You can watch that on WGN America.
How WGN!
Amazing was that, like, seeing that. Right. I went, wow.
And it's amazing to watch, like, All In could set up some sort of deal to get on WGN, but somehow Ring of Honor completely fucked up the deal that they're working on to be able to get on WGN.
I remember back in 05, TNA was, like, it was all but done that they were going to be on WGN, and then just the last second it fell through, and that was when they ended up getting the Spike TV deal.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
Yep.
Yeah, WGN is supposed to have a Saturday morning wrestling show coming up. I can't remember the name of it, but it's pretty cool to have morning wrestling on again Saturdays.
What promotion?
I can't remember the name of promotion. I think it's a newer promotion. I'll look it up real quick.
Yeah, I'm interested now because I didn't know about this.
It's called the Accidental Wrestling Federation.
I wish. Maybe one day.
We
get some money marks to invest some money.
I know.
We got to get some sort of local flair.
We already got
Does Dan
miles.
Gilbert like wrestling? He likes buying dumb shit. Maybe we can get him to do it.
Seriously.
Or Elon Musk, he likes doing dumb shit too.
Yeah, that's true too.
Shot hard on two dudes who have seen more money in a week than I'll ever see in my entire fucking life twice over.
Maybe Chris Illich, Bill Ford Jr.
Oh, yeah, there we go. Yeah, let's
pick that name up right there.
Some other Detroiters out here and see.
My boss, Bezos.
Yeah, there we go. You know what? Out of all of them, he probably would be the one.
I could see him doing that. He would be like the champion of the promotion too, because he's so jacked.
Oh yeah, dude. Yeah, we pull him over.
Would Jeff Bezos' gimmick be that he's actually secretly an agent of the Russian Federation?
Yes.
And then it's revealed that Rusev and Lana are his benefactors. Is Jeff Bezos an agent for the Soviet Union? Oh God, rest in piss, Alex Jones.
It's not funny.
Hey, I'd suck a golf ball through a hose if I had to. What?
Ring Warriors, that's the name of the promotion.
Ring Warriors, okay.
Mm. Ring Warriors.
Do we know who's behind it at all?
Animal and Hawk.
Oh, man.
Chicago, yeah. Chicago stand up, even though they're from Minnesota. Never got that.
Never got that.
So, Ring Warriors is making a comeback and doing it with a splash. They're rebooting with a new 1-hour television show on WGN America. The Las Vegas, Nevada based promotion made their announcement on their official Facebook page late Monday night. This is from late July, by the way. The new show will be on September 5th in the 8 a.m. time slot. The first set of tapings is from Samstown in Vegas, August 8th and August 9th.
Oh, is that so Kazarian's promotion?
I think it might be.
I've been hearing good things about that. That's why. Like, he's gotten a bunch of like rock and roll guys really.
Oh, like
into
how Billy Corgan.
Like Corey Taylor from Slipknot or something says he really loves going there and watching it.
So the listed guys are Marty the Moth, Santana Garrett's a woman. So listed talent. Jeff Cobb, Luke Hawks, Austin Aries, Eli Drake.
Oh, wow.
Wes Briscoe, Cassie Riley, Chase Stevens. So some old TNA names.
Wow.
Yeah, man.
The Naturals.
Cassie Riley wasn't one of the Naturals.
No, it was Chase Stevens and Andy. I want to say Andy Murray, but that's the old Georgia Bulldogs quarterback. Can't think of the other guy right now.
I know exactly. Andy Stevens? Oh, those Chase Stevens, Andy, they're not brothers, Andy something. Because they feuded with America's Most Wanted, because they basically were just palette swaps of each other. They both wore headbands.
Chris Candido was their manager, too, I remember.
Yeah.
Right before he passed away.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, and one of the episodes they taped aired after he died, and they had to put the thing that this happened after he passed away or before he passed away.
It was crazy because the show closed with him like celebrating with the tag titles, and he was in a wheelchair, which ended up causing the blood clot.
Andy Douglas was his name. But that's pretty cool to have morning wrestling on Saturdays. There's probably a good chance that I will never catch it live.
Yeah, 8 a.m. is so damn early. But when I was a kid, I would wake up that early for Disney's one Saturday morning. So the kids won't have a problem checking it out.
If they gear it towards the kids, it definitely will
That's what they got to be doing if it's going to be on at 8 a.m.
Yeah.
I couldn't imagine Austin Aries like, I'm going to kick your ass.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah, eating your little bowl of cereal. Mom, what's ass?
It all sounds good, but the name is too close to Ringworm, which is what I think, you know? Ring Warriors, Ringworm.
Oh, man. It reminds
me. Lino is always concerned about skin infections. We did an episode a long time ago making sure you clean your damn rings.
That's
clean
your gear.
That'd be such a great gimmick for attacking the ringworms.
And they could have the makeup artist put like little fucking marks and shit on them.
Like, they're not concerned with beating you. They just want to give you ringworm.
Oh, God. And then like some heel tag team wears like a CD, like a hazmat suit, or they wear like a bunch of plastic on their clothes so they don't get infected.
That's how you beat them. Oh, man. That's amazing.
I would love it if Austin Aries pulls out a bottle of bleach and just sprays one of them in the eyes.
Oh man, someone's gonna steal that gimmick now.
Yep. Yeah, you heard it here first. And it's going somewhere.
Copyright Pod Bros 2018.
So I guess maybe we could probably try to somehow connect this back to All In. So Ring Warriors on WGN America, 0 hour for All In on WGN America. Now the pay-per-view itself will be on Fight TV, which of course works with Ring of Honor and does all their pay-per-views.
Mm-hmm.
And then of course somehow All In will be on the Honor Club. I don't know how that's going to work with some of the other contracted talent on that show.
Mm-hmm.
But the matches are starting to come out. You know, Stephen Amell is going to fight Christopher Daniels on the pay-per-view. There's
Joey Janela versus Hangman Page.
Hangman Page. The winner of the Battle Royal on 0 hour will face Jay Lethal for the ROH title on All In.
Oh,
now.
Wow. I didn't know that.
One of the Young Bucks said that it would be during All In, which is cool. And it led to a lot of speculation as to who it could be. It's in Chicago, so people thinking it's probably going to be Colt Cabana. But then people starting to worry that some of the matches might not be the kind of matches you would want to do in this sort of situation.
Yeah.
They're thinking you should have all these blowaway matches. But I think what they're trying to do is make it so it's a little bit of something for everyone.
Right.
You can't just have everyone doing flying knees and half Nelson suplexes.
Exactly. Yeah, man.
You know, everyone working, I wouldn't say the New Japan style because there's so many diverse styles in New Japan, mm-hmm. but, you know, what people kind of perceive as the stereotypical, like, hard-hitting Japanese style or indie style.
Who's Okada facing? Okada's facing someone.
Marty Scurll.
Marty Scurll. That's what I thought it was, but then I was like, no, it can't be Marty.
Okada's definitely going to win because he's not going to lose to a junior.
Yeah, they keep running this bit where Marty's trying to get up into heavyweight.
Yeah.
And Nick Aldis just is hilarious in it.
Yeah, because they're homeboys, right?
Yeah, yeah.
A lot of people were surprised that Jay Lethal got the belt back. A lot of people, myself included, wanted Marty to get the belt, but because he's positioned in New Japan as a junior, and most times when the ROH champion shows up in New Japan, they're considered heavyweight.
Mm-hmm.
It would kind of be jarring, probably, to the audience. Excited for that match. Kenny doesn't have a match yet.
No, Kenny is not booked yet.
Pentagon doesn't have a match. A lot of signs are pointing to that being the main event.
Ray,
Bandito, and Phoenix.
Okay,
against
Bandito
the Bucks
was the one I could. And Bucks and Cody?
Ibushi.
Yeah,
that's right. Kota Ibushi is what I meant.
Kota Ibushi.
The over budget battle royal is the greatest name for a battle royal that I've ever heard in my life.
I just got to dump everyone they booked into that match.
Yep, the over budget battle royale with an E at the end.
It's Cody versus Nick Aldis, right?
For the NWA title.
NWA title, that's right, yeah.
So,
which Nick took a shot at Triple H.
He says he's got the real belt, and the belt that Triple H has is the replica, even though the belt Triple H has is like the real belt.
Yeah.
I think it has the dent from Harley Race's head.
Yeah.
In it.
Yep.
Wow.
Yeah.
Why does Triple H have it?
Because he's an NWA mark.
Yeah.
Huge, oh, so he just bought it?
I think Ric Flair just gave it to him. I was going to say Flair or Harley Race gave it to him.
One of those guys. Huh. And you know he is basically both of those guys combined.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's like Triple H grabbed them both by the fucking forehead and Kali-Ma'd them and took their abilities. Like, do you remember that weird time period when Triple H was just somehow both Harley Race and Ric Flair?
Yeah, he had like the Harley Race facial hair, yeah, and man, he would do all Harley Race's moves.
And then he was trying to wear different colored outfits, like his Ric Flair. He had purple and blue, and then you have like the black with the white.
The
boots
white,
like,
yeah.
Like, what the fuck are you doing? Oh,
awesome.
The purple at WrestleMania. So bizarre.
And oh, SmackDown, amazing. Here Comes the Pain, you actually have to unlock his black gear. And I was like, oh my God, I can't wait to unlock this. So it was either only red or purple. So you had to unlock the black shorts. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me?
Oh, that's hilarious.
Like, Triple H only wears black. Why is he wearing purple? This is terrible.
Oh, that is such a rib in the game, man. That's so funny. That's awesome.
Like, imagine grinding, like, hours. To unlock Triple H's black fucking tights.
I was going to say, that's worse than having to pay like the $500,000 to unlock the hoe in No Mercy.
I still have not unlocked the hoe in my copy of No Mercy, and I've had that copy since 2007.
My copy finally hit that glitch like a few years ago. My little brother was playing it, and he was like, I came home from work, and he was like, I am really sorry, man.
Yeah,
I go,
you can't
what?
Beat the game with the created wrestler. You know, it erases everything.
Yeah, I don't know if it worked. I thought I didn't have that glitch copy, and I had it forever. And then one day he was like, I turned it on, everything was gone, and he thought I was gonna flip out and punch him. I was just like, no, dude, it sucks. Yeah, but what can we do about it?
This is crazy.
Yeah,
man. Because I am just now finding out that was a common glitch. Yeah. I thought that only happened with my game.
No, it was a huge common glitch.
Wow,
it's one of the reasons why, like. That unbelievable glitch is one of the reasons why I wouldn't ever consider No Mercy like the best of all the N64 games, because of that glitch right there. It's game breaking and erase all your shit.
Yeah.
So you could never, and then like you could do like Royal Rumbles and story mode and shit. And unless you already had positioned your created wrestlers, you know, if you're playing the game all day, you could do it. You didn't make your created wrestlers like the champions, and they would never show up in anything.
Yeah.
And they never show up in Royal Rumbles or anything.
Yeah. Right.
So it's kind of just there. The only way you know if you got a glitch copy or not, if your copy doesn't have the glitch, no one bleeds. For whatever reason, that was like the trade-off. It's like you want to be able to beat the game with your creative wrestlers. You don't get to make people bleed.
Wow. Yeah.
Because those are some of my worst memories from childhood was when my No Mercy would just delete everything that I did.
That's such a bummer.
Because it's like I didn't do anything to deserve that.
Yeah. No, I got lucky. I don't know.
I'm just glad I wasn't the only one.
It took like 20 years before it finally glitched out. I was like, wow, okay.
Oh. Wow.
Man.
How did we get here from All In?
I'm sorry, man.
No Mercy was...
Yeah, I'm trying to...
Triple H. Nick Aldis being in All In, just calling Triple H out because Triple H supposedly didn't want him. And then he thinks there's someone in the company that's burying him. Someone's burying him.
But I don't think it's an issue with him. I think it might be an issue someone might have had with his wife.
Probably.
I think that's what it is. Yeah. But, you know, it's funny Nick Aldis says that because he's basically just British Triple H. But
That's the funny. I mean, didn't he even say that? Like, didn't he pretty much mention? He was like, I pretty much mirrored myself after Triple H. So
you're
totally right where he is, British Triple H. So who knows? Who knows? Maybe after this, maybe after All In, we'll see Nick Aldis in the NXT zone. So
I don't see any way he doesn't lose the belt to Cody.
You think he's going to keep it?
He will be handing it over to Mr. Rhodes.
Okay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's going to get bionic elbow and everything under the sun. Cody's going to get blood in his blonde hair, dye his hair blonde again.
Yep.
There's going to be belt shots and. All this might give his wife like a Death Valley driver, not Mickie James, but Cody's wife, Brandy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That would be very insane if Mickie James just randomly showed up at All In.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
But is that it? Yeah, Kenny and Pentagon don't have matches. I want to say Pentagon might have originally been in that six-man tag. So they haven't revealed what the actual main event is. And I love the idea of a Pentagon-Kenny match. But I was like, that's going to be the main event? You know, I'm waiting for something bigger.
Now I feel like that Cody Nick might be the main event.
Cody said that it wasn't the main event.
Oh, okay.
Hmm. They go, maybe that someone Jay on Twitter
one, man.
Someone asked him. Someone on Reddit had a great idea about that, but I'll say that in a second. Someone asked Cody on Twitter, "Is that going to be the main event? Or is that the match you're looking for the most?" He said, "No, the main event is." And people were like, "Well, that's very cryptic."
Yeah, man. Interesting.
Kenny doesn't have a match. People were speculating it'll be Kenny versus Punk.
Yeah, right.
Punk's going to be at the meet and greet, which that's going to be awkward.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah.
And Brian hasn't resigned yet. Am I correct in saying
that? Yeah, but Brian even said he was like, my contract basically ends pretty much at midnight. So I think he made some joke about how if the show went on till 12:01, then he could come out. But he was like, no, I can't make it.
Okay. Because I thought once your contract ends, you can just opt out of the no compete clause, correct?
Yes. Yep. Okay. Yeah. That was, yeah. So, but he said basically like his contract ends that night.
Okay. So, what's the trade-off if you opt out of the no-compete clause then?
You don't get paid. They pay you a good sum of money within those 3 months.
That makes sense. So, yeah.
A lot of people take it because they'll just take the money.
Yeah, just get paid to sit and do nothing.
Yeah, you get to relax, heal up, and then you can figure out.
Cabana didn't want to take it. He was wrestling as soon as he got released. He was back in the Indies.
Yeah.
And I want to say Brian took it the first time around when he got fired. In 2000. Yeah, because he was back in the Indies right away. But what was I going to say? Oh, so back to the over budget battle royal. You have Flip Gordon is doing the all out thing.
Oh, is it?
So I think Barry the Bear, whatever his name is, Cody always has like his mascot. People are speculating that the bear will win, rip off the mask. It's Flip Gordon, and he gets the ROH title shot. So it'll be an all in. So I gotta imagine they're not gonna have all this build up and not have him be on the show.
Yeah, not have him in the show, right? Yeah. So, because I mean, they've been playing that for a long time now.
Yeah. And then isn't he basically the Young Bucks like six man partner now that Adam Page is kind of doing his own solo thing
in New Japan? Well, they say that's what partially it. So they take him under his wing and stuff. And you know, he wasn't a member of the Bullet Club, even though they wanted him to be. But now I don't even know what's going on with that. I don't know if it's just they were like, oh, okay, the Bullet Club is over.
Except I don't understand that dynamic anymore. It's kind of lost on me, especially with the chaos of G1 going on.
Yeah,
it's
right?
Like the Bucks. Chase Owens always teams with the elite guys because he's cool with them because the Tongans beat him up too.
Yeah, even
I thought he was
an
honorary Tongan.
Yeah, I know, man. Yeah.
But then Kenny doesn't like Cody, and then Marty is just kind of just like, I don't want to be a part of this war.
Marty was like, I didn't want to be in here to begin with.
So this is like very confusing.
Yeah, it's really weird.
And then Kota is in the Elite with the Bucks.
Mm-hmm. The Golden Elite.
This is so fucking confusing.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. It is, man.
I need some clarification. But anyway, quick G1 spoilers from a couple weeks ago. I'm still way behind, so I have to catch up this weekend. But Adam Page, they clearly like him in New Japan because he beat Togi Makabe and he beat Minoru Suzuki.
I was going to say, I knew he beat, I didn't know about Makabe. I heard he beat Suzuki. And the only thing I knew was that they did a gimmick thing on being the Elite where Kenny gave him this book, like the success on winning or something like that. And he's like, after you gave me this book, I beat a bunch of guys. Blah, blah, this is great. And Kenny's like, I need that book back, please.
Oh, yeah, because Kenny had his, as far as I know, his first loss. I am completely behind on everything else. So someone is probably screaming at their computer phone about something else, but I don't know.
Who knows? We forgot to mention the ghost of Joey Ryan is supposed to be somewhat involved with All In as well, so they haven't really booked him.
What is...
huh? Adam Page killed Joey Ryan in Japan. And then Christopher Daniels told the Japanese police that it was Steve Amell. And so Steve Amell got arrested, and then they cleared him, but they still don't know who killed Joey Ryan. Adam Page is having a multiple personality disorder right now with himself, because he's freaked out now that he killed Joy Ryan, that he's going to get caught.
All right.
But then they saw Joey Ryan at Disneyland or Disney World. I see you. That group. Joey Ryan walked by and they're like, was that, huh? And that was it. So. Poor Joey Ryan's hot wife. That's what they call her.
Listen, the wrestlers, I appreciate and I love the fact that they're using YouTube and social media and all these platforms and being creative. That's awesome. I fucking love it. But it starts getting real confusing when the shit that they're doing on their own starts bleeding over into the show, because it makes shit not make sense at all. Like, Bullet Club are essentially faces besides Cody in Ring of Honor. Mm-hmm. Confuses the shit out of me, mm-hmm. because, you know, not long ago there was a show where they hijacked the show and super kicked literally everybody at ringside. Yeah. Now, what's her name? Rosemary and Allie from Impact Wrestling, mm-hmm. they do a similar thing where they have their own universe. And then there's something I saw on Twitter where Rosemary is feuding with Courtney Rush on Twitter, who they're the same person. Oh, because after Rosemary got set on fire by Sue Young, apparently, like, Courtney Rush got her body back. Huh. And now she's like, I've been gone for 2 years and I have no fucking clue what's going on.
Wow.
Amazing. I'm like, what the fuck is happening right now?
I love it.
I was like, fuck, like, now I gotta go back and like catch up on all this extra shit. Yeah, it's like trying to keep up with these damn Marvel movies. Like, I gotta watch 7 YouTube specials to make this one match make sense.
It's a lot to try to wrap your head around.
Yeah, like, there's an alternate universe in which the Canadian wrestler has been possessed by a demon, and the demon died, and the wrestler woke up and was like, shit, where have I been for the last 2 years?
That's amazing.
What the fuck?
I got to catch up on that one. That's sweet.
Man, fuck. So much extra work, man. So much wrestling. So much content.
Yeah, it really is. We've said that before. So much content.
The head of my microphone was coming off. Probably because I'm swinging it around in a very questionable manner in front of my face, if you want to visualize that.
Nice.
Anything else we want to talk about?
Jeez. I know at the time this comes out, Clash Wrestling Saturday, there's some stuff that's going on controversial there, too. Spoke with Elk on the Accidental Wrestling Fan Clean version. Check that out, the Caveman Elk. And how he was omitted from the poster, even though he's in the main event, even though he's a former champion.
But isn't the poster just all the champions?
I don't know if it's all the champions. It might be. I don't know. Hmm. But they don't make any mention of anyone else on the poster or anything like that. So there was the whole poster gate.
Hashtag poster gate.
Yep. And then they put him on the poster. But they covered his face with the Clash and Burn. And then they blamed it on the editors, and the editors put it out, and they're like, we're not even fixing it. So it actually got the fans pretty pissed off. It was pretty funny to see, not going to lie, because there's a lot of pissed off people on it. They're like, are you serious? So they told Elk to pipe down, and this is what they did, and they retaliated. So I love it. I love it.
Wow.
Are we getting worked? Or what's going on?
They don't want him to be on top, just like WWE doesn't want Roman Reigns to be on top.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So, yeah, check out Clash Wrestling if you're in Taylor.
Yep, and check out John's interview with Elk and the other.
Soon to be Scotty Freetown and me got back in the studio. They'll be out hopefully by the time this comes out, too. Also, Toph Clean. In which we discuss DSW, some of the matches that are coming up. Also, I think August 25th, Brass Monkey. Check them out. We're still hoping. I think what we were all discussing kind of a little bit off air is we think Toph Clean might start to be geared more towards us doing interviews with people. And we'll see how it goes. But yeah, trying to build Toph Clean back up. And go from there.
So this is a second interview with Scotty Freetown then?
Yeah, Scotty and I just, we rehashed the old DSW show that just happened at Brass Monkey. Talked about the results of that, talked about some of the wrestlers to look out for. And then also kind of being the first place to drop off all the the announcements of some of the new matches that are coming up. So we found out Scotty and that wrestler Logan are actually going to have their third and final match, I'm assuming.
Rubber match.
Yeah, the rubber match, last man standing.
That escalated quickly.
Yeah, man.
I was thinking two out of three falls.
No. They are going to kill each other. This last match that they had a ring, like a apron spot that I fell in my seat because it looked like it hurt so bad.
Oh man,
they should do a last man standing match, but then they just take all the padding off the ring. It's just the wood.
Oh no.
Oh dude. Oh man. Ouch. Yeah.
Oh man.
Yeah. So yeah, a lot of great local indie stuff going on and has been going on. I really hope is to get Briar in studio to talk about some Horror Slam too. So
yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I got
awesome.
A message.
We gotta do
in.
That.
Yeah. Yeah. Reach out to him.
Yeah, I need to start getting to more shows, but hopefully a couple things go my way. I will definitely be catching more shows because I'll be local more often. So
yeah, man. Yeah. Evolve Sunday too as well.
Yeah. I got to figure out how I'm going to do that. I should be able to make it, even though I have to do this pedal bar thing with my family. So because I don't want to have to like take like a lift or anything from Detroit. Like, yeah, that'd be kind of pricey. Yeah. So I might have to see if, someone can come scoot me after the pedal bar is over. We can head out over there. Go to the Knights of Columbus Hall in Livonia, pound some $3 whiskey and cokes. They make them strong, so make sure you got someone driving you, and watch one of Matt Riddle's last indie matches.
That's in my neck of the woods. I should go to that. What time is that at again?
6:30 or something like
okay.
that.
Let's check. I think it's what Evolve 111.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so Matt Riddle is going to be there.
Yeah, he will be there.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. I thought he was done.
Let's see.
Well, shoot. Now I feel that I really have to go.
Yeah, I know. I wanted to go see they did the last match with him and Keith Lee.
Yeah.
And Keith Lee's last Evolve match was there, and I missed it. It says Sunday, 4 p.m.
4 p.m.? Holy.
Yeah, it says Evolve 111, Livonia, Michigan, from 4 to 7 p.m. You know what? Because I think there's a progress show. Yeah, and I think, let's see, Progress Wrestling Michigan. I wish I could go to both. Like, now I'm...
Where's the Progress show at? I didn't even hear about this one.
Same venue?
No, I think it's in
that'd
Detroit
be pretty sweet
proper.
If it was back to back.
Yeah, they've been doing these double headers with Progress. I've been saying Progress, but I feel weird saying it the way you're supposed to say it.
It is Progress, right?
Yeah. Oh, it is in Livonia at the same place right after 8 o'clock.
Oh, really?
It's a doubleheader.
I knew that.
Oh, my gosh.
So
you going to go?
I might be able to make the second one. I am absolutely going to end up missing the Evolve show. Yeah. By the time I got done hanging out with my family, it would be in the middle of the show. So I can't go. That is a serious
bummer.
Family stuff.
I
thought it was last weekend. That's why I was like, maybe I should go to this. And I realized that they were in Boston and... Progress was doing a show on like Monday and Tuesday last week. They were doing shows for like 4 days straight because they're doing this big American World Tour. And apparently Chris Brooks and Jonathan Gresham had one of the best matches of all time for the promotion against LAX.
Oh, really?
Yeah, apparently just absolutely insane match.
Oh, sweet.
And I don't know if he's the owner or he's the guy that always does all the in-ring promos and hypes the crowd and everything for progress. And he basically said, I can't believe LAX doesn't get booked more because they're so good.
Yeah.
Because they pretty much only wrestle, as far as I know, for Impact. I'm sure they wrestle in other promotions, but you don't see them in Ring of Honor or anything else. So they had that match with the Homicide and Hernandez at the last pay-per-view, Slammiversary, I think it was, for Impact.
Yeah.
God damn, that match is fantastic. Those dudes are really good.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, shout out to LAX.
Sweet. A lot of wrestling. A lot of wrestling.
And
Progress will also be in Chicago the day before.
Oh, wow.
Yep, another doubleheader the night before as well. So much damn wrestling. And then my coworkers get mad at me because I've never seen all of Breaking Bad. Like, you know how much fucking wrestling I gotta watch to do this podcast?
Yeah, dude, man. Yeah. I mean, keep up.
Even just watching WWE by itself is enough work. Seven hours of content in the first 3 days of the week.
I feel like I cancel plans and do this whole Sunday thing. Bring the mic. See if I can get some interviews.
Yeah, I would love to be able to maybe just go to the Progress show after the family thing, but I got to imagine that's sold out.
Maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, we'll see. I might have to ask on the interwebs.
Yeah, right.
They always have sweet merch, too. They had the shirt for the Seattle shows.
Oh, God, yeah.
Damn, like, all this sweet wrestling merch. I don't make enough money for this.
Yeah, I did.
And I still got to buy my own stuff. Like stuff that I helped design and I still haven't bought it yet. I don't buy my own shit. How great
pretty,
is that?
I've been pretty good. I've been pretty good. Every time it comes out, I pick up a shirt. Got to represent. Maybe I'll wear my Detroit wrestling shirt if I go.
Yeah, if I can find a way to get out that way after the pedal bar, I'll be sure to rock the Detroit wrestling shirt.
Got my self-made shirt last weekend. So
And I wanted to get that in tank top form, but it's pretty much tank top season is over because we live in Michigan, so it'd be gym only after that.
Yeah, we're in like the halfway through the fourth quarter of tank top season right now. You won't get much use out of it if you're gonna get one.
As the summer is over, like September 20th, 19th, something like that.
Yeah, 20th. I think
so. I got like 6 weeks of summer left. Pretty much pointless. All right, well, that's it for this episode of the Accidental Wrestling Fan. That's it for Tank Top Season. If you have any other questions, suggestions, things that you want us to talk about on the show, if you're interested in being a guest, topics, anything like that, be sure to send us a message on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, at TA Wrestling Fan. You can email us at thebros@podbros.com. And make sure you join our discussion group. Just type in the Accidental Wrestling Fan and our main page will pop up. And also it'll say in parentheses, discussion group. Come on down, chat with us. Conversations have been getting kind of slow. I was going back and looking at the old SummerSlam 2016 or 15 thread, and we were going nuts
just on
in
fire.
So people were very upset about the Brock Lesnar Undertaker match.
Who was that?
Who could have possibly been upset about that match?
Yeah, there's no one in this room that was absolutely boggled by that finish.
Cause you and I were cool for the summer.
Get well, Demi. Is that her? Is that Demi or is that Selena?
It's Demi. You got
Demi.
It. Yeah.
Get well, Demi. For real. Get well.
Yeah, yeah, man.
When life hits you with the shitty finish, what should you do?
Tuck your chin, brother.